Get him out of here. Yeah, don't give him his coat. Don't give him his coat. Keep his coat. Confiscate his coat. You know, it's about 10 degrees below zero outside.
While Donald Trump blusters, bellows, and blows his way through opponents while avoiding any real talk about issues, his poll numbers rise, and those scrambling for a position beneath him try to find ways of inducing voters to look their way. This includes having to fend off another round of ridiculous birther talk, crafting new and snarkier ways to insult everybody else, and basically eating their young and the old. Is it possible, then, that the divide-and-conquer strategy of Trump makes Democrats feel warm and secure in the knowledge they're the beneficiaries? Or is it just possible someone can rise above the din and quiet a GOP civil war? Sauce for the Goose, great place to start in this edition of The Political Animal. Veteran Democratic media strategist Cate Communications in Tampa, who, like so many others, has come to the fact the Buccaneers bring new meaning to the words clueless and chaotic, Franco Ripple, joined by the Georgetown University professor, Republican strategist, who, like so many others in that area, would love to see the Redskins play in one more Super Bowl before the end of recorded time. Not going to happen this year, Bradley Blakeman. All right, gentlemen, let's get right to it. Wall Street Journal today, headline, "The GOP Establishment's Civil War with a free-for-all between Christie, Rubio, Cruz, and everybody else." Brad, is it just possible that this was the plan all along for Donald Trump? Let him fight it out, let the young eat themselves, and then just walk away with the win. And that there's no way you can stop this civil war right now.
No, there isn't a civil war. It's called a primary. And in primaries, that's exactly what you're supposed to do, is you're supposed to get and field the best candidates from within a wide field of participants.
But it doesn't seem like that, though, Brad. That's the point. It doesn't. To a lot of people, it seems like all they're really doing is tinkling on each other and making fun of each other and insulting each other instead of talking about substance.
Donald Trump has really brought things to a new low. And unfortunately, people are queuing off Donald Trump. Why? Because he's leading in the polls nationally. Look, but push comes to shove. We've got, in just a few short weeks, we have the first Iowa caucus, and then we have the first primary in New Hampshire. So things are going to change, I think, a lot after Iowa. I believe that Trump will not win Iowa. It's possible that he won't even win New Hampshire. And then we're off to a whole different race with a whole different set of circumstances.
Franco, let's be really honest here, and I want you to do that on the left, because we always talk about a civil war on the right. But is it not fair to say that there is discourse going on the left as well? Because Hillary Clinton is certainly no slam dunk in Iowa right now. Bernie Sanders is making inroads. It's not as if her coronation is dead set. And there's a lot. And look what happened this week. They're going after Debbie Wasserman Schultz, basically saying that even she's not fit in some ways to lead the party. You guys got your own troubles. Come on.
Well, those people are absolutely wrong. Debbie Wasserman Schultz, I think, is doing a great job as DNC chair. She's running a tight ship and a competitive one at that. But, you know, yeah, Democrats have always, and I've said back to last year on this program, Democrats have always wanted to see a competitive process. I think you've got three great candidates in the race. You know, one of them, Martin O'Malley, no, really does not have
you
a chance.
You actually said three great candidates. I want to mark that down because you're the only person who has said the number three in the last 3 months. Okay, very nice.
That's true. Even Vice President Biden said recently two great candidates. I think Martin O'Malley is an attractive character in politics, but I don't think he has a chance at the nomination. I do think it is between Sanders and Clinton. But the reality is, when you look at the Republican side, I'm going to disagree with Brad. There is a real civil war going on that side of the aisle, because Republicans right now do not know who they are and what they want. And that Wall Street Journal piece, I think, was wrong. It said that part of this was because Donald Trump has forced the party to face some issues that they haven't wanted to talk about. This is not about issues. This is about a party that does not know where it is at this point in time or where it's going.
I'm really light on time, but Brad, I got to let you answer that back from Franco here, because I think he just threw down the gauntlet.
Well, if anything, it shows that our party has got a huge talent. We have vying for the nomination. They couldn't be more different yet alike, because we're Republicans and we believe in the tenets of Republicanism, which is small government, low taxes, freedom of choice, and most of all, the ability to own a gun. So I think that there's great differences between us, but we have more commonality than differences.
All right, about 90 seconds left. RNC committee, our RNC chairperson, Reince Priebus, said last night that the party will back whomever ends up the nominee 100%. Donald Trump, Senator Cruz, anybody else. Here's what he said.
Whoever the delegates of our party choose, that's going to be the nominee, and our party is going to be behind that person 110% to save this country.
All right, Brad, do you think he's actually able to deliver that 100%? Because, hey, Jeb Bush recently said he wouldn't back Donald Trump, so it seems like Reince is maybe throwing a little hot air out there.
Well, look, he's technically correct. I mean, the delegates will choose, and the question is at that point whether the party will support. That's the party rank and file, not the delegates. So it remains to be seen, but Donald Trump will be have a hard time unifying our party and would have a hard time in a general election. While he may be selectable, if that's possible, by the party, I don't think he's electable by the people, and therein is the rub.
All right, 30 seconds left. Coming back to you here, Franco, on the left, again in Politico. Insiders, Clinton and Cruz are not sure bets in Iowa. Do you think that Hillary Clinton is a rock-solid sure bet in Iowa?
No, no one is a rock-solid sure bet in Iowa. Sanders could certainly come back. I think it's likely that Hillary Clinton wins there, possibly also New Hampshire too. But the key thing on both sides of the aisle is that front runners historically can afford to lose one or two of the early contests and still win the nomination. And I think that could very well happen here for Clinton.
Do you think there's a little panic among some people in the DNC that Hillary may not ascend to her throne?
I don't think there's any panic in the campaign or the DNC or anywhere else because, again, frontrunners can lose a contest. When you look at her strength nationally, she's well out ahead in recognition of her historic strength as a Democrat.
And it's only Iowa. We have a long way to go, much like the Buccaneers and the Redskins. I had to get the last shot in there. Franco knows I'm honest, thanks, too, and so does Brad. Franco Ripple, Bradley Blakeman. Gentlemen, thanks so much for joining us. We'll talk to you soon. You need and want an electric car. Look into my eyes. Hear the truth behind that thinking many call a great con job. It's coming up next right here on The Hardline.